Hello, you multi-model glue sniffers. And thank you to Alec K for that malt mention introduction to a rum review, which happens to be Ralfy Review 679. There we go. And this happens to be a bottle of Compagnie des Indes single cask rum from the Bellvue distillery in Guadeloupe. Guadeloupe is to the south of Montserrat, to the north of Dominica, and it lies somewhere in the middle of that volcanically inspired necklace of islands that surround the surround the Caribbean Sea. I'm going to pour a glass, and I'm going to tell you that when you're getting into rums, it's a bit of a journey. And there's actually quite a lot of seriously old rum distilleries out there that are still doing things an old-fashioned way, but it just doesn't get noticed because of the dominance of a few major brands like Bacardi and Captain Morgan, i.e. Diageo. And it's really interesting when you look up the history the checkered history and the occasional shenanigans that goes on around some of these old rum distilleries. The rebellions, the murders, the intrigue, the changing of hands over a gambling debt, all that sort of stuff. And of course, it goes back far older than for Scotch whisky. Scotch whisky in the spirit world is a relatively recent invention as a matured spirit. It didn't really happen till the late 19th century, whereas rum goes right back to 17th century, easy, even 16th century in some instances. And of course, you have the oldest continuous running distillery in the world is a rum distillery on, what's it called again? Oh dear, senior moment, 3, 2, 1, Barbados. There we go, I knew I'd get it when I put myself under pressure. Oh my goodness, let's have a whiff of this. This is most definitely a molasses rum, you can just tell. It's from the Bellvue distillery in Guadeloupe. But what you need to know is there's two Bellvue distilleries. There's one that produces rum using sugarcane juice, and that can be found on Grande-Terre, La Moule, I think it is. I wrote it down, La Moule, yes. And the other distillery is on the smaller Guadeloupe island of Maria Galante. And it's very characterful, a real character. Bottled at 43%. This rum was distilled in March 1998. It was bottled in July 2015 and is 17 years old, which is quite a hefty age for a rum. However, it wears that age quite elegantly. It doesn't smell tired. And the reason's simple. If this rum had matured the 17 years on Guadeloupe in the tropics, it would simply be maturing a lot more quickly, at a lot faster pace, and eventually it would pan out into a soft, raisiny, less complex event. I've noticed this with a few old rums, whereas spending much or most, if not all, of its time maturing in France, probably sharing a warehouse with some fine brandies, cognacs, etc., and you do get a note of cognac on the nose, funnily enough. Not quite sure what to make of that. But it's simply allowing a more paced, prolonged, gentler style of maturation, which you find specifically with this bottler. The nose is quite camphorish. Molasses, yes. Elegant, complex, yes. But there's something slightly minerally about this. Something delicate despite its intensity. And I'm noticing certain resinous notes, including eucalyptus, camphor, wintergreen, and mint. Not quite sure what to make of that. I'm seriously wondering if at any point a certain wood has been used, a style of cask, for holding even this rum, or whether it's been matured for some period of time with an inner stave of eucalyptus. The thing about rums is you simply don't have the same transparent regulation as you have with Scotch single malt whiskies, and which is being adopted by whisky makers elsewhere around the world. And it's something that the rum industry collectively really need to tighten up on to promote a higher specification of reputation and thereby encouraging more sales of their product. Simple equation, and it would work. The sweetness is restrained. It is more monosaccharide than disaccharide. That really is a kind of chemistry, a way of saying it's more fructose, glucose than sucrose. And in being a little more of a gentle sweetness, it really allows the other complex congeners involved in this rum to express themselves a little more clearly. Having worked in the nose, how does it translate to the palate? Long, long arrival. Sweet and sour. Sour, bitter. Minty, most certainly. Dry, mineralated molasses. And it's this dryness in the rum which is really extending and pushing along the development after that initial exciting complex arrival into what is a really quite tasty, full-bodied finish, which then extends further. So a real long run on the tongue with this rum. But it's bottled at 43%. What I'm finding from experience is when you're adding water to this, very, very little. It's as if the 17 years, which is an old age for a rum, has retained the intensity but developed a delicacy in the form. If I was to add even half a teaspoonful of water, this rum would start to lose its mojo. So I've got to add some water. There we are. Half a dozen drops of water, roughly. And that's all this will need. It's really quite refreshing, and a good reason, malt mates and rum rascals, to go for independent bottlers, and why I'm preferring them at the moment, is that it's clearly not sweetened, and I don't believe there has been much in the way of additional colourant in the form of E150A caramel colouring being added to this. It doesn't have that orangey glow. This is a little bit more walnut in appearance, the colour, and it suggests that it's natural colour, and the nose alone is suggesting that even before you taste it, that there has been no additional sweetness added to make it more rum-like. Thank goodness for that. Wonderful stuff. This is a sort of rum that any whiskey drinker who is looking for that alternative moment is going to thoroughly enjoy, and importantly, relate to sooner rather than later. I've added some water. I've given it a few minutes. I'm going to back for another tasty taste. Oh, the arrival. More brown sugar. Muscovado in with the molasses. The molasses has taken on more of a fruit, and there's more tannins in there coming from the cask, in my opinion. It really has softened the arrival, but given you more complexity, as substantial as you will find from any Scotch single malt, I guarantee it. the development initially is a little bit hesitant. It's a little bit restrained. And frankly, it's a little bit soft. However, with just like whiskey, a minute in the glass for a year in the cask. It doesn't apply to the same extent with rums, but particularly noticeable with European or temperate matured rums. The longer you leave the rum in the glass with a tiny drop of water, the more it will slowly unravel and reveal its intrinsic complexities, which tend to get caught up when you initially pour a glass due to the nature of sugar derivative spirits. Behaves a little bit like corn, you know. Oh, we're getting there. That mintiness. It's almost as if it's got a dry Tia Maria note. Beautiful, complex molasses, muscovado, cocoa. There is a little bit of gunpowder tea in there. There's something really quite minty, almost spearminty. We're getting a bit of fresh mint. We're getting certainly some wintergreen, quite dry, almost astringent wintergreen, and a touch of fennel too, almost bitter anise. It's a fascinating, elegant old rum, which has got character. I'm intrigued about these kind of eucalyptus minty notes, and I'm wondering where the hell they're coming from. Personally, I'm attributing it to some other flavour contributor in this rum, and there's no rules and regulations against it. It doesn't inhibit it in any way. In fact, it improves it. It's almost as if they've popped in an inner stave from a eucalyptus tree or a red bark tree from Australia. It's just got that thing going on. But it makes this rum all the more intriguing and satisfying. So here we are, 17-year-old. I'll give you the cask reference in case it's still out there. This is cask number CG14, from which there has been 298 bottles. There you go, now you know, just saying. Imported and bottled in France. Wonderful, lovely. I was about to say malt mark. It's not a malt mark, you ralfy rascal. It's a rum mark. What are we going to give this? 87 out of 100. It's a rum mark. And now, for some more rum topical tips, pointers and general advice. Another site for rum reviews, which I'm going to recommend, is thelonecaner.com. It's a traditional blog, and I noticed that the calibre of the reviews are consistent and well-informed. That's why I'm recommending The Lone Caner. I'll put a link down below. That's where you go, down below in the descriptor box. And I'm also going to put a link to the world's largest rum festival. Now, this video is being uploaded onto the internet for the entire known universe to see on the 30th of August 2017. A month later, not a month later, 30 August, September, 6 weeks later, a month and a half later, in London will be Rumfest. And you can go to rumfest.co.uk to get the tickets, which are still on sale. And I'm going to recommend Rumfest in London to you if you happen to be around, as probably being one of the most exemplary established rum shows to be found anywhere in Europe. It's certainly the biggest rum event for the members of the public in the world. And the tickets aren't as expensive as going to a whiskey show in London. That helps. But what also helps is, particularly if you're a whiskey drinker and you've been to whiskey festivals. To go to a rum festival is something different. There's a different feel, a different vibe, a different tone and a different texture to the entire event. The stands from which the rum is being served are a lot more colourful. There's a lot more investment goes into them. It tends to be a more musical, noisier, gregarious event. And I'll pop a link down below to a video that you can see on YouTube giving you a flavour, excuse the pun, couldn't resist it, of Rumfest in London, the world's biggest rum show. And do you know what, malt mates? I think I'll get me some tickets for that. Yeehaw! Drying out this rum, and as it gets drier, it gets more interesting. It's almost as if it's flipped. It started out a sweet arrival and a dry finish. Now it's becoming a dry arrival with a sweeter finish. Intriguing. It's, if you can't make Rumfest in London, no worries. Such is the growing, I never rehearse these things. Such is the growing popularity of rum, particularly sipping rum now, globally, that more rum events and festivals are cropping up. Whether they are being organised in cities somewhere near you, or whether your local specialist tiki bar, theme bar, or whatever bar happens to have a rum night where you can just go along and sample maybe about half a dozen or so different rums. It's a really good way to get started, to find information and to get your palate round the rum experience. If you are a whiskey fan, you will have no problem using the experience you've already got and gained with Scotch whiskey and other whiskies, or bourbon, or mezcal, or brandy, and transposing that experience into examining, appreciating, and engaging with rums. There we go. I think that's quite enough now. I'm going to head off back to the ship. I'm going to see how my shipmates are. We're going to head out into the Irish Sea and we'll probably sink a galleon or two just for fun before we scoop up the treasure, just as before it sinks below the surface of the briny ocean, well, briny sea. And then we will merrily sail back to some remote cave somewhere at the top of a high tide line to consume rum, eat sandwiches. It's not very pirate, is it? Basically say cruel things to each other. That's what you do. You know, it's expected. I'm Ralfy. When you come back again, I'll be back to my good old-fashioned single malt whiskey reviews. And I'll be reviewing Linkwood. There you go. Now you know.